Whenever you study the Bible, it's always important to make sure that you let context reign supreme. And by that I simply mean you let the Bible tell you what it is saying, why it is saying it, to whom it is saying it, so that you don't have the need to inject your own interpretations and your own biases into it. This text in particular, Romans chapter 2, is one that could easily be broken up and chopped into pieces and taken in a lot of different directions by people who refuse to keep it in its context. But when you put this text in its appropriate context, and you allow Paul, the author of it, to explain it in the framework of this letter, it makes perfect sense as a as a complement to what came before it and as a prelude to what will come after it. He had finished chapter 1 with the latter third of that chapter being devoted to the various sins committed by the patriarchs, by the Gentiles, and how because of that God looked at the entire system of the patriarchal life and found no righteousness therein. There were some who were faithful, some who were obedient. Noah, for example, was a patriarch who was obedient, many others. But in terms of an overall system, there was no righteousness to be attained under the patriarchy. You come now in chapter 2, and Paul turns his attention to the Jews and to the law of Moses and to the giving of that law to this nation and how still God finds no righteousness therein. And in the context of this chapter, Paul discusses a lot of the antagonism that the Jews had for the Gentiles, a lot of their own personal pride that they felt, very kind of negative pride, I mean, that they were the chosen people of God, they were the chosen nation of God, and because God gave them the law, that entitled them to salvation, while the Gentiles were just forced to scurry over table scraps. And Paul has to completely reset that thinking and explain to the Jews, his Jewish brethren, that that is not the way God intended the system to go down. And so as chapter 2 opens, it opens right as chapter 1 closes, a very natural transition, I mean. Chapter 1 ends with the rebuke against the patriarchs, and at that rebuke, many Jews will be reading that, celebrating God putting the patriarchs in their place. But Paul is quick to say, but you are also guilty. He opens verse 1 of Romans 2 by saying, therefore thou art inexcusable, O man. And we know right off the bat, therefore, Paul's talking to his Jewish brethren, even though it's very clear in a few chapters he mentions the Jews by name. But it's clear from verse 1 on that he's talking to Jews because of that expression, O man, which is a common way for a Jew to describe and to address another Jew. So he says, you are also without excuse, inexcusable, O man. Whosoever thou art that judges, that is, of the Jews that like to look down on and condemn their Gentile citizens. For wherein you judge another, you condemn yourself. For you that judge do the same things. You who condemns a Gentile for this particular sin, you are guilty of committing the exact same sin. And it's only by your arrogance and pride that you can't see that obvious hypocrisy. Because they believe that they were righteous just simply by virtue of being Jews. And so they were well within their means, they thought, to condemn a Gentile for thievery while themselves being thieves, for condemning a Gentile for idolatry while themselves worshiping other gods, and so on. So Paul opens it by saying, you're in just as much of a bad boat as the Gentiles. In fact, you're worse off because you had a written law chiseled into tablets of stone, memorized from birth, whereas the Gentile system was different. Theirs was not like that. So how can you condemn them when you can't keep your own law and it was written down for you? Verse 2. But we are sure that the judgment of God is according to truth against them which commit such things being the sins mentioned at the end of chapter 1. His point here is to say God's justice is blind. It is equally distributed. He does not show favoritism, and he'll say that specifically later in the chapter. But he doesn't show favoritism to one nation over another or one nation less than another. Judgment of God is nonpartisan. It is not nationally biased. So he says it is according to truth. If you obey the truth, whether you're a Gentile or a Jew, you'll be blessed. If you reject the truth and disobey it, whether you're a Gentile or a Jew, you'll be condemned. Verse 3. And do you think this, O man, that judge them which do such things and do the same, that you shall escape the judgment of God? Do you honestly think that if you condemn a Gentile for committing a sin that you yourself are committing, that you can somehow escape the judgment of God? You're quick to point to them and condemn them and promise judgment to them. But when you do the same thing, do you really think that you can avoid the judgment of God? Judgment for me, but not for... Or judgment for thee, but not for me. That's their attitude. No, absolutely not. But they thought they could escape it. Because we're Jews, was the mantra. Well, of course we'll escape God's judgment. We're God's people, but that's not the case. Verse 4. Or do you despise the riches of His goodness and forbearance and longsuffering, not knowing that the goodness of God leads thee to repentance? The Jews despised the riches of God's grace. They rejected it. They felt just simply secure enough in having possession of the law that God gave them at Sinai. They didn't actually need the law. They didn't want to follow the law. They didn't really believe in the law. And they didn't really care much about the God who gave the law. But just knowing that they had it was enough for them as a security blanket, as a teddy bear to sleep with at night. So Paul says, in so doing, you've despised all the blessings that God provides to those who are obedient to that law. The riches of His goodness. That word means kindness or usefulness, an ability to help someone who can't help themselves. You despise God's forbearance. That word means self-restraint. God could have just decimated your nation, completely obliterated you, and He would have been just in so doing because of your sins. But He had restraint. He restrained Himself and gave you chance after chance after chance to repent, though they did not. They despised the riches of His long-suffering, His patience, as God worked with them and nurtured them from babies to middle age to adulthood, spiritually speaking. But yet along the way, they continued to reject Him and spat in the face of His patience. Do you not know, Paul says, that the goodness of God leads you to repentance? All these things that God offers you is supposed to soften your heart, to lead you to repent. But they won't repent because they refuse to see that they've sinned. They don't see their problem, so they won't repent. And so they reject the goodness of God. Verse 5, and he describes their attitude here. But after your hardness and impertinent heart, hardness, calloused, unmovable, unfeeling, and impertinent, unrepentant, a heart not willing to say it's wrong and then make changes. And through those two things, he says, you treasure up unto yourself wrath against the day of wrath and the revelation of the righteous judgment of God. As you persist in your sins and your unwillingness to repent, you are basically just storing up for yourself. The King James says treasures up means to store away for a later date, like to squirrel away. Instead, you're not squirreling away nuts for the winter. You're not squirreling away money for a rainy day. You are squirreling away God's judgment against you. You are angering Him, and the anger is bubbling and bubbling, and the cup is about to be full and run over. You are squirreling away the wrath of God against you, the day of wrath, the day He finally unleashes His judgment against you, reveals His righteous judgment against you, Jews, not the Gentiles, but you who condemn the Gentiles. Verse 6, God, when He does that, will render to every man according to his deeds, whether they be Jew or Gentile. Everyone according to his deeds, the work that he's done, he'll be judged by that work. How you lived your life, whether you were faithful or unfaithful, obedient or disobedient, so you will be judged. Completely destroys the concept of once saved, always saved. Once I'm saved, I can do whatever I want and God won't condemn me. No, you'll be judged according to your deeds. You'll be saved by the grace of Christ, but you'll be judged according to your deeds. And if your deeds are evil, you'll be condemned. If your deeds are faithful in Christ, obedient to Christ, then you'll be blessed forevermore. Verse 7, to them who by patient continuance in well-doing, that's a fancy way of saying faithful living, to those who are continually patient and do well, who are right with God, those people seek for glory and honor and immortality and eternal life. Look at the blessings that will come to those who have faithfulness, to those who have loyalty, to those who have obedience to God. He says those faithful people will have glory. They'll be lifted up. They'll be praised by God. Humble yourselves before God and He will lift you up. Glory. They will have honor, value. They will live up to the potential that God sees in them. They will have immortality, uncorruptibility. The salvation they have won't decay, won't wear out. It won't fizzle away and fade away. You'll have it. It's immortal. Now you can lose it, but it won't decay. As long as you have it, you're, it's not going to wear out. But you can walk away from it. You can remove it. God can take it away from you if you refuse to be faithful to him, which is the point of verse 6. And then the last one he mentions is eternal life, which is often synonymous with immortality, but think of it like this. It is not just perpetual existence. It is not just surviving forever. It's thriving forever. It's a life that is lived with God in paradise with him that gets better every day. On the 1,000,000th day, when we've been there 10,000 years, whatever, it will be even better than when we first begun. Verse 8. On the other hand, those who are not faithful, those who reject obedience to God, unto them that are contentious, that word means rebellious, who don't obey God, and do not obey the truth, but instead obey unrighteousness, to those people there are four things that they can expect. The first two are mentioned here, indignation and wrath. Indignation, which is the actual word, means wrath. The word wrath later means something else. But indignation means wrath, or to take vengeance on someone. And God will take vengeance on those who don't obey the truth and those who don't know God. The word wrath here is the word that means anger against an injustice. So put them together. And what Paul is saying is God sees your unrighteousness. God sees your sinfulness, and it angers him in a very just way. He is offended by it. And so he will take vengeance on you because of it. Last two sins mentioned in verse 9, or not sins, but punishments, are tribulation and anguish. Tribulation means, typically it refers to harsh circumstances, but the word just means to be restricted, to be constricted in a tight, narrow, hard place. Think about it like this. The Jews thought of the word joy as a fountain that flows open and free, big, wide open spaces, happiness. This is the opposite of that. This is constricted, narrow, difficult, hard. So God will bring tribulation to those who are not faithful. God will bring anguish, the pain of suffering, to those who don't follow him. That will come upon every soul of man that does evil. Your actions have consequences. Of the Jew first, and also of the Gentile. So it's not just that the Jews are also on the hook along with Gentiles. It's that they are more on the hook. Because as we've noted, they had the law written down. They had a covenant relationship with God through the Abrahamic promise. If they reject it, well, it's doom on them even more so. Verse 10. But glory and honor and peace to everyone that works good. He says in the previous verse, everyone that does evil will be punished. But if you work good, if you are obedient, if you do what God wants, you will have glory and honor. Those two we covered back in verse 7. And peace, the third one. Calmness, serenity, being still, being at ease. You will have those things to everyone that works good, to the Jew first, and also to the Gentile. Again, punishment and blessing comes to the Jew first, because to them was the written law given, to them was the covenant relationship established, and then also to the Gentile. Verse 11, because there is no respect of persons with God. And here's one of those times when the verse needs to be kept in its context. There are certain circumstances, certain things where God is a respecter of persons. An elder cannot be a novice, a new Christian. A deacon cannot be a woman. There are all kinds of examples where you can say this person and only this person, not that person, can fulfill this role or this obligation. So in that sense, there's a respecter of persons. But just in terms of general salvation and condemnation, which is the subject here, there's no respecter of persons with God. Now the whole point of all of this, the reason Paul's writing all this, is to point out to these Jews who in their arrogance were condemning Gentiles while committing the same sins of the Gentiles and not condemning themselves. Paul says there's no respecter of persons with God. He's going to condemn both, whether Jew or Gentile. He's going to bless both, whether Jew or Gentile. Verse 12, because as many as have sinned without law, that would be the Gentiles, shall also perish without law. Now, he doesn't mean they didn't have a law that they followed. He means they didn't have a written law the way the Jews did. He's contrasting here. So he's saying, look at the Gentiles. Those Gentiles who sinned without having a written law, they'll be punished not having a written law. On the other hand, there are the Jews who sinned in the law. They had a written law. They had a covenant relationship with God. Those who sinned will be judged by the law. everybody's going to be judged. Everybody's either going to be blessed or condemned, and it's going to be under the parameters of the relationship of God that He defines for you. To the Gentiles, it's a nature, a law that He'll get to in a moment. To the Jews, it is a synanic law written down for them. But either way, doing right brings blessing, doing wrong brings cursing. And if there is right and wrong doing, there is a law implicit in that idea. It's just one is written, the other one is not. Now, as verse 12 ends, the thought does not end until verse 16 and beyond. But from verses 13 through 15, there's a parenthetical, like a little sidebar. So let's notice that. For not the hearers of the law are just before God, but the doers of the law shall be justified. This is a direct shot at the bow against the Jews who thought, well, we've got the law. It's written down. It's over in a cupboard somewhere. We've got it written down and kept away. And God says, it's not hearing the law that makes you right with me. It's doing the law that makes you right with me. It's not just having a law written down. It's obeying the law that's written down. Verse 14, for when the Gentiles that don't have the law do by nature the things contained in the law. When they do things in the law by nature, when by nature they do the things in the law. See the way he says that? How do they do the things in the law? They do them by nature. And he'll explain that in just a moment. When they do those things that are by nature contained in the law, even though they don't have a law, they become a law to themselves. This is Paul's way of getting around the idea that how can God punish or bless Gentiles when they didn't have a written law. And Paul says they had a law. It may not have been written down on tablets of stone, but it was still a law. And when they obeyed God by nature, they were making a law unto themselves to follow. Now, how do you obey God by nature? Well, think about this. Do you think there was any Gentile ever who was right with God that disobeyed his mother and father? Could a Gentile be an idolater and be faithful to God? No. But a Gentile who was not an idolater, who worshiped the one God, and Gentiles who obeyed or had honor to their father and mother, they were obedient to God. They were right in the sight of God. They were doing right by God. Those are natural laws. Those are universal things that God expects of His creation. On the other hand, there are things like keep the Sabbath day holy. Here is the proper way to kill a goat to offer it on an altar. Don't eat swine or pork. Those sorts of things are not natural laws. They are parts of the covenant relationship and the special agreement God has with this particular nation, the nation of Israel. That is their national law that God uses and governs among them. But in terms of a universal, let's call it a moral law, honoring parents, not being rebellious, not being an idolater, not murdering, lying, stealing, etc., all of those things, when the Gentiles did those things, they were obeying that natural law, the law unto themselves. Verse 15, and they show the work of the law written in their hearts. It wasn't written in stone, like the Jews had. It was written in their hearts. Their conscience bore witness, and their thoughts, the meanwhile, accusing or else excusing one another. Excusing one another. In other words, Paul says, as they followed that natural law, and they were faithful and obedient to God, they had a relationship with God which trained their conscience for what to do or not do, to accept or to not accept, to accuse or excuse. And so their conscience was attuned by God's word, spoken to them as God spoke to patriarchs. It was not attuned through reading a written law as God dealt with Israel. It was attuned to a patriarchal kind of way as God spoke to the heads of families. And those either obeyed or did not obey. God spoke to Noah and told him to build an ark. That was a specific commandment. He obeyed. God spoke to Abraham, told him to leave his father and mother. He spoke to the head of that house, and he obeyed. God speaks to the world and tells them, don't commit adultery, don't commit idolatry, don't commit murder. And those are natural, universal laws. Obeying those laws brings life. Disobeying those laws, you don't need them written on tables of stone. God says what not to do. God has told the world how to obey them, or what the punishment will be for not obeying them. And so obeying or disobeying, accusing or excusing for the Gentiles comes through speaking with God and following the conscience that God has trained for them. Now, when you come to verse 16, you have to read it as though it follows verse 12. Because as I said, 13 through 15 is the sidebar. So again, verse 12 reads, verse 12 says, for as many as have sinned outside of the law shall perish outside of the law, As many as have sinned in the law shall be judged by the law, contrasting Jew and Gentile. They're both in the same boat, blessed or cursed, depending on how they follow the law God gave them. Verse 16, they'll be blessed or cursed, 16 says, in the day when God shall judge the secrets of men by Jesus Christ, according to my gospel. So how will a person who is disobedient to God, or rather, let's put it this way, what will happen to a person who's disobedient to God? If he's a Gentile and he's disobedient to the moral law that God gave, or if he is a Jew and he's disobedient to the Sinaitic law that God gave, what happens to them? They're going to be punished. Well, what happens if someone is faithful to God? Noah was faithful to God. Not all the time, but in general. So what happened to him? Hey, Adam, again, not a perfect person, sinned obviously, but was still faithful. What happened to him? He didn't have the Sinaitic law. He didn't have the law given at Sinai by Moses to Israel. So how is he deemed right in the sight of God? If there is no righteousness in the patriarchal system, if there is no righteousness in the law of Moses and under the Israelite system, how is anybody right? The answer comes in verse 16. They are right in Jesus Christ. They are made right by the gospel of Jesus Christ. And that's the overall point he made back in chapter 1, verse 16, that the gospel is the power of salvation. There's no salvation under the patriarchal age. There's no salvation under the Levitic age. Salvation comes at the cross of Christ. Well, how are those people before the cross of Christ saved then? If they died before it happened, the blood of Christ goes in both directions. And the details of that Paul will cover actually in chapter 4. But let's move ahead. Verse 17 says, behold, you are called a Jew and retest the law. The word means to rely upon, to be comforted by. The Jews thought in just possessing the law that that was good enough. In fact, Jesus condemns that idea in John 5:39 when he says to the people, to the Jewish leaders, search the scriptures because in them, literally in the possession, in the holding of them, you think you have eternal life. Instead, you should search the scriptures and you'll see that the books testify of me. So the Jews thought that you could rely on having the law as your method of salvation, and they would make their boast of God. Well, if it was the case that having the law could save, then they could boast. We have the law, we get to be saved, but that's not the way it works. You're allowed to be saved by your obedience to God, not just by possessing something God, you know, wrote down for you. It's like someone saying that they have a relationship with God because they have their family Bible. You know, it was passed down from his mama, from his grandma to his great, from his great grandma. Well, I have the family Bible. I have something close. I'm close with God. No, you're not. You just have a book. If you don't search the scriptures, you don't have anything. Verse 18. You know his will and approve the things that are more excellent, being instructed out of the law. You were given the written commandments to know what is right and wrong. And what did you do with them? You cast them aside for traditions. What did the Jews do? They set aside the law of God and started following their own customs and their own opinions. Verse 19, you're confident that you yourself are a guide of the blind, a light of them that are in darkness. But in fact, Jesus will tell them that you're blind leaders of the blind, that you're blind leading the blind and you're both going to the ditch. But you are so confident that you can lead the blind, that you can be the light to people who are in darkness. But you're not. You can't be, he says in the next verse. You're confident that you're an instructor of the foolish, that you're so wise, that you're a teacher of babes, of babies, that you're so mature. When you have a form of knowledge, you have a semblance of knowledge, the word form means, an appearance of knowledge and of the truth in the law. You seem like you know what you're talking about. You seem like you could be a good guide. But when you actually dig under the surface, these Jews are not good guides. They're horrible guides because they don't know the law. They know their traditions. They know their customs, and they're quick to tell you those. But they don't know the Word of God because they don't really believe in it. They have it in their possession. They know where it came from, but they love having it more than studying it. So they have just a semblance. They're bluffing when they talk about following the Word of God and guiding people through it. Verse 21, you therefore which teach another, do you not teach yourself? You who preaches that a man should not steal, do you steal? And then that thought continues in 22, you that say a man should not commit adultery, do you commit adultery? You that abhors idols, do you commit sacrilege? The Jews love to burn the Gentiles but they never seem to get hot. The Jews love to teach others, but themselves never learn anything. They love to tell everybody else what they were doing was wrong, but they themselves would never change. And it was because they had such a great arrogance. They believed so strongly that they were chosen, and they took that to mean that they were predestinated, that they were predetermined to be saved no matter what, and that they could just live however they wanted and they would be saved. And that's never been the case. They were selected to bear the fruit of humanity's salvation, the Messiah from the nation of Israel. That's the extent of the relationship that God set apart for them. In every other aspect, apart from the fact they were given a physical law, they are just in the same boat as the Gentiles, and that's a large point that Paul's making here. But this idea that they were so special is why they could condemn others but never look at themselves, because they never thought they had a need to. They don't ever do wrong, so why should we look inward? Verse 23, you that make your boast of the law, notice the boast in just having the law. Well, I have the law. I'm boasting about the law. But you break the law, and in doing so, you dishonor God. By breaking the law, aren't you dishonoring the God who gave you the law? Paul asked that as a rhetorical question. And the answer is yes, of course they are. But they didn't see it that way, because they refused to see that they could do wrong. They just thought, if I do it, I mean, I can tell you not to steal. If I steal, because I'm God's chosen people, I must have had a good reason. You know, I can excuse myself, but there's no excuse for the Gentile who steals. I have an excuse. I'm God's people. I had a reason to do so. That kind of arrogant attitude is horrible and condemned in this text. Verse 24. For the name of God is blasphemed among the Gentiles through you, as it is written. And that's basically the paraphrase of Isaiah 52:5. That the Gentiles are abhorring God, or rejecting God, or turning away from God through the actions of the people who claim God is their God. The Gentiles look at the nation of Israel, they look at the God of the nation of Israel, and they see the Jews have so little respect for Jehovah that they will disobey his every command. The Gentiles think, well, then why should I have respect for him? If his own people don't respect him, why should I? If his own people won't obey him, why should I? So through their actions, the Gentiles disobey God. Through their inactions, the Gentiles dishonor God. This is why James writes in James 3:1 that teachers have an extra burden on them. They can receive the greater condemnation, because it's not just their soul that they're caring for when you become a teacher, it's the souls of those you teach that you're partially responsible for. Partially. In the end, we're all responsible for our own salvation. But if I am teaching you the gospel and I teach you error and you follow it and you're led astray, well, you're responsible for your own actions, but I'm responsible for teaching you that error. If by my actions or inactions and my sins, I cause someone else to sin, I'm partially responsible for that, and I'm going to be partially condemned for it as well. Not to mention wholly condemned for my own sin in so doing. Verse 25. For circumcision verily profits. Now he's digging into the whole nature of the Jewish arrogance problem. That I am Jew. I have a covenant relationship with God. I've been circumcised on the eighth day according to the law of Moses, according to the covenant of Abraham. So I am special. And here's how Paul dismantles that idea. He says in 24, for circumcision verily profits if you keep the law. You're being circumcised only profits if you're faithful to God. If you break the law, your circumcision is made uncircumcision. If you aren't going to obey God, you might as well not be circumcised. You might as well be a Gentile. Now that's them fighting words for a Jew to hear. But Paul says if you're not going to actually keep the law, you might as well not even have been circumcised. You don't even have the covenant relationship. Oh, of course I do. I'm a Jew. Covenant relationship is with the nation. No, the covenant relationship was with the faithful of Israel. That's why only the remnant left captivity. That's why the unfaithful died in captivity in Babylon, in Assyria, in Persia. God spared the remnant. He didn't promise all the Jews life. He promised the faithful Jews life. So this idea that I'm special because I have the covenant, Paul says, no, you're special if you obey God. And if you're a Jew, that means you obey him in the law. If you're a patriarch, that means you obey him by nature. And that's the whole point he's making here at the end here. Verse 26, therefore, if the uncircumcision, the Gentile, keeps the righteousness of the law, if the uncircumcision obeys God, and as we read earlier, by nature, then shall not his uncircumcision be counted for circumcision? He basically takes the previous verse and flips it. He says in the previous verse, if you're a Jew and you don't obey the law, you might as well not even be a Jew. Well, what is the opposite? If you're a Gentile and you obey the law, you practically are a Jew. Now again, that's a horrible thing to tell a Jew, but it's God's truth. If the Gentiles, again verse 26, keep the righteousness of the law, then even though he's uncircumcised, he's going to be counted as circumcised. Now he's still going to be uncircumcised, but he's going to be counted as. The word means reckoned or treated as, regarded as. Even though he's not, he'll be looked at as though he is. And that is an important word we'll get to in a couple of chapters. But God will look at the Gentile and say, I can have a covenant relationship with this person because he is obedient to me. That's how God determines his relationships. Faithful obedience, not a medical procedure and your birthright. Verse 27. Shall not uncircumcision, which is by nature, if it fulfill the law, which is what he said earlier, if the Gentiles do by nature the things in the law. So in that case, shall not the uncircumcision, which is by nature, if it fulfill the law, judge thee, who by the letter, by the written tablets of stone, and circumcision, transgress the law. What's he saying in verse 27? He says, if anybody should be condemning anybody, it should be the Gentiles condemning you. It's not just that you shouldn't condemn them. It's if anybody, they should be condemning you because they don't have a written down law. They have the law through the patriarchy system, and if they can keep it and you can't, then they should be condemning you because they're right with God and you're not, even though you're a Jew and they're a Gentile. They're uncircumcision, but they can fulfill the law by nature, and thus they could judge you who does not fulfill the law, though it was written down for them, for you, transcribed in stone for you, and yet you transgress it. They should be condemning you, not the other way around. Verse 28 and 29, this summarizes Paul's point. And through this two verses, we get the meaning behind all of chapter 2, which is shame on you Jews for condemning the Gentiles for not being faithful to God when you had the law of God and you still weren't faithful either. And so he says in all of chapter 2, it doesn't matter what nationality you are. God looks at your obedience or disobedience in a general sense. Verse 28, it's not a Jew that's one outwardly. You're not a Jew. By that, I mean, you're not the chosen people of God just because you're outwardly a Jew. You were born to a Jewish family. You were circumcised the eighth day. You study the law. You keep the law, or not keep it, but have the law. That does not make you a Jew. You are not a Jew if you're one outwardly. Neither are you circumcision if it's just outward in the flesh. You don't have the marker of your relationship with God, the physical marker that you are of God, circumcision, if it's just an outward thing. If all you have to show for it is the physical surgical procedure, if that's all you've got to say that you have a relationship with God, you have no relationship with God. I mean, I can have a Bible in my hand, but that doesn't give me a relationship with God. Just because you shoot Jesse James don't make you Jesse James, as the saying goes. I can put on a baseball hat, but that doesn't make me Babe Ruth. You can get circumcised, but that doesn't make you a Jew. You can have the law. That doesn't mean you're keeping the law, if you want to obey it. Verse 29. But you are a Jew if you're one inwardly. That is, if your heart is right with God, then you're a Jew. And in that case, it doesn't matter what your actual birthright is. And the circumcision is that of the heart in the spirit and not the letter. Your salvation is not dependent on your just ritualistic obedience to commands. Now, don't misunderstand that. What I'm saying is your salvation is not of works, lest any man should boast, which is how he ends the verse, whose praise is not of men but of God. If God determined your salvation based on your ritualistic obedience to written down commands, then in your obeying those specific commands, then you could boast. Look what I've done. Look what I've accomplished. But your salvation isn't from written down commands. It's from God. Your glory and praise goes to Him, not to yourself. Salvation is not of works, lest any man should boast. It's from grace and obedient faith. Nevertheless, there are commands God gives you to obey. But just obeying them without the heart is irrelevant. You being circumcised doesn't make you a Jew. You getting dunked in water doesn't make you a Christian. You become a Christian when you obey from the heart, as he'll say in Romans chapter 6. And so there are commands you must follow, and you must follow them, but you must follow them physically from the heart, spiritually. Mark 16:16, he commands you to be baptized. Just getting dunked in water won't save you. But if you believe in Jesus Christ and you're baptized, if your heart is changed and you obey, then you will be saved. Not before, not during, but after. Then you'll be saved. So Paul says, you're a Jew if you are one inwardly. If your circumcision is of the heart, in the spirit, and not in the letter of the law. And if your praise is not of men, but of God. Because the Jews were all about praise from men. Look at me, I have the law. But here, Paul says, no, you should be God. Look at me, I'm trying to be obedient. And that is chapter 2. Now, from chapter 2, the Jews have a question to ask. In chapter 1, Paul says, look at the patriarchy system. There's no righteousness found therein. And the Jews celebrate. So Paul says, wait a minute. There's no righteousness there either in the legalized version of the law of Moses under the Jewish system. There's no righteousness there either. So that after all of that and that very dismantling of their entire religion, the Jew might say, well, then what purpose was there to have the Jews? What advantage then do the Jews have? And that's chapter 3. So we'll pick up chapter 3, which opens with that discussion, and then we'll end with a conclusion of this first part of Paul saying, all have sinned and fallen short of the glory of God. Nobody is going to be saved as a patriarch or as a Jew under those systems. You're going to be saved by the gospel of Jesus Christ, by His grace, and through His blood. We'll pick up with chapter 3 this time next time. Until then, thank you very much.